Hey guys, welcome to another episode of Cigar Chat, brought to you live on CigarFederation.com, broadcast around the world on the Armed Forces Radio Network. Thanks for tuning in wherever you are out there in the world today. Appreciate you spending some time with us. Robbie Raz from Cigar Federation here with you. As always, Logan, did I come in with enough energy for our new intro music that if you're watching live, you can't hear?
Ta-da! That's what you need to do.
I've been working on it. I've actually go back.
You're not the most enthusiastic person I know.
No, and I go back. I'm trying though. I'm going back and listening to old episodes and how could I do it better? And then I think, man, John could just do a better job on the editing on the back end.
Or you could just be more like me and be more awesome.
It's
tough.
I'm playing with the hand I was dealt at this point.
Yeah, it's just true.
How was your Easter?
It was good. Did the Easter egg hunt with the little one. She took some amazingly cute photos.
Awesome.
And I'm beginning to realize that the female version of me is much better looking and cuter than the male version of me. And I'm kind of glad.
That's lucky for everybody.
I know it is. It's very true. But no, yeah, I hung out, did some stuff. I have a funny story about Home Depot and Allie's expensive tastes and how we had to buy imported India and sandstone for a project.
Nice.
And I'll tell you later because it'll make me cuss because no, I'm just quite angry about it.
It sounds like a great story, but
actually is.
No one tuned in for that. Although I don't think anybody tunes in for the first 5 or 6 minutes of the show.
No, actually, I think they probably tune in for me because I bring comic relief. And if you notice, my camera is fixed.
That's a given. And your camera is fixed. It looks much better.
Thank you, sir.
Today we've got the guys from Atelier and Surrogates here hanging out with us. We've got Casper and Dan are here, guys. Thanks for joining. Casey's going to be on. He's on his way back from basketball practice.
I think lacrosse practice.
Lacrosse practice.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, he's coaching something, and he's on his way, so he'll pop in at any time. But appreciate you guys hanging out, taking the time to hang out with us.
Yeah, happy to be here, man.
Yeah,
absolutely.
This is the first time, Dan, that we've had you on the show, and we got through some technical difficulties, but we're all the better for it now. I think we're good to go. And I think Casper, it's been like 2 years since we've had you on, man.
Yeah, I think it was. Was it after the show?
It was October, September-ish of
14. Then.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think it might.
Well,
it might
be last year.
Yeah.
So yeah.
There you go. It's been a while.
Yeah. It's been a while, man. It's good to see you trimmed up the beard.
Yeah. Well, we did a little photo shoot here in the office for an upcoming advertisement. And
nice.
It was getting pretty unruly, so I thought I'd bring it down for a little while. It'll come back.
That's funny. That's the exact same term that my wife uses for my beard. What she says is starting to get unruly, and she actually said that yesterday. So I need to tighten it up myself. But
it was 9 months. I had it holding out for 9 months and then cut it off.
That's I respect you for it, man. That's
it was ridiculous.
Rob, so Dana doesn't like the CQ tickler.
Yeah, see, I have no comment. I did not trim mine up for the photo shoot, so I look like a goat.
You keep it clean, though. You keep it clean. I like that. No, I've seen some of the pictures floating around that you guys took. They look pretty cool.
Yeah, there's some funny ones that we took, but the real ones are pretty cool.
It just doesn't grow any more than that.
Oh, so it's got the hard stop right at...
That's all it does.
Yeah, I'm getting, nobody, this isn't beard chat, but whatever. I'll hang on to it as long as I can. The wife likes it, but I just got to keep it tight. So let's jump in. I mean, Casper, we've had a chance to talk with you. Dan, why don't you give us, a little bit of your background, because since this is the first time we've had a chance to chat with you on the show.
So, well, I've known Pete since about 2000 when I was traveling back and forth to LA, and there's a really long story that I won't tell about getting into the Grand Havana Room as a member, but it's funny. Basically, Pete got me in, but I didn't know that. I thought I was special. I met him at the shop that he was running for the Grand Havana Room, and I inquired about the Grand Havana Room and eventually filled out an application thinking there was a couple-year waiting list, and a couple months later, I was in. He had a lot to do with that. I thought he didn't at the time.
It's always good to know people, man. Always.
Yeah. Anyways, we started hanging out at the Grand Havana Room pretty much every weekend. I was traveling back and forth, trying to do the acting thing, thinking I was going to move out there. That's why I thought I would join and, you know, it would be a couple years before I actually got in. And then when I got in, I started going out, and pretty much every weekend I ended up at the Grand Havana Room rather than my acting classes. So Pete and I got into wine about the same time, started driving up into Paso Robles together, and so we just kind of had a similar palate, and he taught me a shit ton about cigars, because at that point I would say I was an advanced hobbyist. You know, back in 2000, didn't have the info that you guys have now available, so it was touch and feel and making my way through the stuff that I could actually smoke at the time. But I had never had a Cuban or anything like that before that era, and then that was the end of that. Pete was already, you know, connoisseur that could look at a Cuban cigar and tell you exactly what it was without the band on it. So I made my way through that realm as well as the rest of my domestic realm. And then I was still computer consulting, so I was a mainframe database specialist here in Central Ohio. And I just got sick of it. I mean, I'd done it for 22 years, couldn't do it anymore. And eventually started a little online store, 07, New Havana Cigars. Mm-hmm. So I got my retail experience from that, and that's where the idea for Surrogates came from. It's kind of a house project slash, you know, thinking that we might do something with it. It was Pete and I, and it was a year later that we started Atelier, and I said, so can we roll Surrogates into this whole project? And he said, yeah, definitely. So that's how Surrogates fits into Atelier Imports. It started off as just two little sizes, and then we kind of went from there.
Nice. So everything kind of falls nicely under that one umbrella, which is good. And the Surrogates line has been it's been pretty successful.
Yeah, so it's expanded to six blends. Six projects, and now this year we're starting to expand the projects. Everybody was asking for a smaller size of Animal Cracker. Animal Cracker was us kind of poking the industry that they were doing all this big ring gauge stuff, 6x60 and above. We couldn't possibly go above because none of us even smoked 6x60, but we thought we'd take our rail at it and say, what would we do if we were going to create a 6x60? And that's how Animal Cracker came about. And immediately, you know, a lot of people loved it, but just like me, they're like, I don't smoke 6x60 almost ever. And I said, yeah, me neither, except for football games. And when I feel really guilty because I haven't smoked one of our own sticks. So I tell everybody maybe every 2 weeks I'll have an Animal Cracker 6x60. But I doubt if it's even that often. So we had done, when we did the five packs, we threw that blend in as cracker crumbs, and everybody loved those. They were eating those up, but people still wanted a normal size. So that's what I'm smoking right now. This is the brand new this week, just hitting the market this week. Animal Cracker 550. So it's a regular 5x50, same blend. We didn't tweak it. We thought we would, because we thought maybe it would be a little too strong, but I kind of like the way it smokes this way. It's a totally different stick.
Nice, nice. Yeah, I'm looking forward to trying that one. The Cracker Crumbs, Logan, that was a big hit.
I can't keep the ish in stock, man. Like, literally, every time we sell it, I order 100 more.
Yeah, I end up smoking them back to back.
Yeah. People love them.
Yeah, that's a great cigar. It's fun to smoke. I'm going to jump in with some of these audience questions here because I actually don't know how many there are, because when I get down to the bottom, it refreshes and adds more. So appreciate all the questions from the audience. And apparently, On asked a ton of questions, and he's our resident Lancero connoisseur, and he says that it's not Cigar Chat if there are no Lancero questions. So this is a three-parter.
So no, no, and no.
part one is not a yes or no question. Part one, what Lancero in the Tatuaje Atelier profile, or portfolio, sorry, is currently the most overlooked?
If it's both portfolios, I got one too.
All right, okay. I'll come back around, but let me get through these here. What is the greatest Lancero you have ever smoked? And part three, why no surrogates Lanceros? So we'll go back with question one, the Lancero in the Tatuai.
Like question 1A.
Yeah, 1A, 1B, and 1C. So this is all on is on it, man. He says, okay, so the first question, the most overlooked in the Tatuaje and Atelier portfolio. Casper, we'll start with you, man, because you had the answer right off the top.
Yeah, I think the La Riqueza.
Yeah.
For Tatuaje, and then for sure the regular Lat Lancero are the two. That would be the most overlooked in the Lat brand for sure.
Now, why do you say that?
You know, we don't make very many of them. They sit in our humidor, and as people know about them, we have them. But I think the Selection Special gets a little bit more shelf space and a little more love. It's a little bit different shape box. It's a 20-count box, darker wrapper. You know, not everybody's looking for, you know, a really light-colored wrapper. And that Latland, the regular Latlancero, has just that beautiful, sexy wrapper that we use on regular Lat. And I think that it gets lost sometimes as a size.
Yeah, no, that's interesting. I know I've smoked it. Logan, have you smoked that in Lancero?
Yep.
What did you think of it?
I'm not a huge fan of the I'll call it the Atelier Original or Classic.
It's too light for you.
It's too nuanced for me. I like a kick in the teeth.
Too nuanced for you. That was a very self-deprecating answer.
I did it on purpose. I don't know. It's not a bad cigar. It just doesn't hit my wheelhouse. I do like the SS. I do like it in the Lancero. Mm-hmm. And then what was didn't you do a Lancero in the Racine too? Or was it like a Lonsdale or something?
Like a
like
Lonsdale.
13?
Hey, there's Lonsdale. Casey.
Oh, Coach.
Hey. All right. Hey. How are you?
Casey, thanks for joining us, man. Appreciate it. We're just kind of going through some questions here, and I want to wrap this question up, and then we'll do a little intro with you, because this is also the first time I've had a chance to chat with you. So,
cool.
So, Dan, what was your answer? Your answer was going to be the same?
Yeah, it's La Riqueza, because no one knows that La Riqueza number 6 even exists. If you ask people what their favorite was out of the Lancero pack, they may tell you Cabai Juan, because mm-hmm. I really loved that, and I'd love to see that actually released. The La Riqueza was probably my second favorite out of that, and it's now a production cigar. Back when La Riqueza got repackaged into 10 counts, it was added as the number 6. I think that's brilliant. But my favorite stick in our entire lineup on the Atelier side is the Atelier Lancero, by far. I love the Sancti Spiritus wrapper, and you just get more of it out of that Lancero ratio. I think the SS wrapper, we all love it, but I think it coats the flavor a little bit. And if you love that flavor, you know, because it does, it has more bite to it, more earthiness to it. And if you love that flavor, you're gonna flock towards that instead of, you know, the more nuanced, lighter wrapper. But that's every, you know, if that's not a question on the side panel, it probably is. What's your favorite stick? But I tell everybody that's my favorite stick. I try not to smoke it every day because I want to make sure it remains special. But
practicing a little self-control. Casey, the question that we were posed from the audience here is, it's a Lancero-based question here, and there's three parts. This is the first part. What Lancero do you feel in the entire Tatuaje Atelier portfolio is currently the most overlooked?
Wow. Probably the one I made. I'm just kidding. That was, that was for you, On. I don't know if he...
yeah, he's the one that on. He's the one that asked it.
Yeah. Most overlooked, I'm going to be right there with Dan on the Tatuaje side. La Riqueza, all day long, is one of my favorite of the Lancero collection. I don't know. From us, you know, Kath, did we go back to just Atelier, or
I said La Riqueza and regular or original Lat Lancero.
Oh, original Lat Lancero. Yeah, original Lat Lancero, because you know what, actually. Being on the road so much, I see, and Dan and I had this conversation the other day, the SS is kind of pulling the meat of the business. And I don't know if I see it in sales, but I hear it in the store over and over again. And it's you know, the Lat Lancero probably is in that realm. As it is with Dan, it's his favorite stick by far. But yeah, I'd agree with Dan completely on that.
Let me ask you a quick question. Is that all three of you have said the La Riqueza and, you know, the Lat original Lancero, you guys are just in love with it.
Mm-hmm.
But it seems like the market isn't necessarily resonating with me. People are just taking it.
Yeah, you're going to need to give us that one more time there, Logan. I heard the market is not resonating with it, but then after that, like, it got robotic.
I'm saying, okay, so basically...
It was all broken up.
It was all broken up. Yeah. All right, here we go. We'll start again. So you guys have named all the same cigars, right? The La Riqueza Lancero and the Atelier Classic Lancero. You guys, number one answer, overlooked. We love this cigar. It's our favorite. But cigar smokers don't necessarily gravitate towards that cigar and smoke a bunch of them, even though you guys love them. Why do you think that is?
I think, from the Atelier side, I think the, you know, if we're talking Lat versus Lat SS, I think the SS is just an easier reach on the profile, and it's not a strength thing, but it's a flavor strength thing. So, we wouldn't have done it if we didn't like it, but you know, it makes it a little more one-dimensional for me. I love the 46. We used to smoke them back to back to back, and I actually love the way the Torpedo smokes. But when it comes down to the Lancero, if I want a blast of just that SS wrapper, then you know, it's not that I don't smoke them, but how many of us smoke a Lancero daily? Anyways, we don't. You know, it's a little bit more. Yeah, yeah, right. That's his pick. Yeah, we know that.
Totally.
So,
go ahead.
I was gonna say, Dan, we'll stick with you. Why no surrogates, Lanceros?
Oh, well, you know, all the surrogates are project based, so and seem to be so far based on trends in the industry. So, if a Lancero trend happens to hit the industry, we might try to do it. But we just haven't, you know.
Good point.
That's all of surrogates is just an inspiration thing. So if something hits us that we would want to do that, a lot of times it's us talking about, you know, what's a missing thing, or you know, what have we seen that we would like to see ourselves do with the Garcia's tobacco. That's how those ideas are coming about. That and, you know, drunken names.
Interesting. No, that's good. Guys, you're listening to Cigar Chat, brought to you live on CigarFederation.com. Broadcast around the world in the Armed Forces Radio Network. We're here with the guys from Atelier and Surrogates today, talking about all kinds of stuff. So far, we've just talked about Lanceros, but we're going to move forward. Logan, this next segment is brought to us by who?
Drew Estate. Smoke them. Back to you, Rob.
God, I love those reads. They're so good, Logan. You're just getting so good at that.
Market penetrating.
That is, it's beautiful. This next segment is brought to you by Drew Estate Cigars.
Good.
They're good. Okay, so this is a good question, and another one for the group. And I'm going to start with Casey because he showed up late. this one's from Trip. And Trip wants to know, which Atelier or Surrogates blend are you each personally most proud of?
Oh, for me, it's that's the ER. The extension De La Racine probably is my favorite. Mm-hmm. It's for me, it's the finesse of the blend. It's how it came about, and this last one, I kind of threw a little hissy fit on the Lonsdale and won. So I'm a little proud about that one too.
So when you say how it came about, let maybe some folks listening might not know the story behind it. So let everybody know how it came about.
Dan, you were in on the phone call with Pete, so here we go. Bring it on.
Oh. Well, you want the real story?
Well, just remember that we are on the radio and we have to keep.
No, it no, it's a good.
I mean, no, it's nothing bad. No, it's nothing bad.
It's nothing bad. It's just an inside story. I mean, we were Casey and I were, and you know, I think Sean was kind of on our side as well. We were trying to push Pete into releasing our stuff before the trade show, because the first trade show we went to was in August, and by the time our stuff really started shipping out. It was well into the fall season. So Casey's in Maine, I'm in Ohio, so we were already seeing the ramifications of the East Coast retailers are slowing down already. It's not season for them. And so Casey was pushing, you know, why do you always wait for IPCPR? And Pete had a great answer, which is, if you don't wait till IPCPR, you know, what reason is there for people to go to IPCPR? And so he, you know, he's like, look, I've been doing this for, you know, 10 years already, guys, so, it, you know, this thing works. And we're like, I know, but if we could just get, you know, that year it was the 46. What else came out that fall or that spring, Sean?
The Maduros.
Maduros.
Oh yeah.
It was 46 in spring, and then Maduros in May.
Yeah, and we had already been to the factory, so we had already blended and knew what we were coming out with, and I was literally driving home to see my mom. And Ellen and I were in the car, and I was talking to her about it, which she could give a crap. I'm trying to explain, like, you know, this dilemma, and just by talking it out, I went, hold on, and I called Pete, and it was probably freaking 7 a.m. in L.A. at the time, and he actually picked up, and I said, hey, I got an idea. Instead of, you know, waiting, and, you know, and or bringing out one and not the others, what if we do something special for IPCPR, and that way we can do what we wanted to do, which is bring something out in March, bring some stuff out in May, and then save something that you could only get if you actually went to IPCPR. And Pete already does it with a TAA cigar, where you go to TAA and he tells you what, you know, what he's going to do for the cigar, and they place the order there, ships it later in the year. So that was kind of the idea, and then we all talked as a group about, you know, if we did that, you know, Sean had already thrown out the name Extension de la Racine as something we might want to do in the future. And Pete immediately threw out, oh, I got a great name for that. You know, Sean was talking about that extension of the root. That's what Extension de la Racine means. And it kind of went from there. And he's like, you want to do, you know, multiple sizes, or do we want to do one size each year? And we just kind of decided on doing one size each year. How did we blend that thing?
That was actually when we first started talking about the basis of Sancti Spiritus and using it in blends differently.
Because of the Maduro.
Maduro was all about. You know, the first run of Maduros didn't have Sancti in it at all, I don't think, did it? Or one of the two blends?
No.
The ones we got in November.
They both did. They both had it. One was slightly different.
Oh, it wasn't binder. It was in filler. Right. Yeah. Right.
No. It wasn't in anything. When we were testing test blends, you're talking, Casey?
No, November. Yeah. Before we went to Nicaragua.
No, there was none in there. That the whole concept of Rob, I saw one of the questions on the sideline earlier today, and I know it's in there, but it has to do with you guys using Sancti Spiritus in everything, and these guys can check me if my memory is different. But when we were down at the factory blending the Maduro, that's kind of how that happened. We were pressing the leaf, or the wrapper leaf, especially me. I was real hesitant, you know, to do another broadleaf stick coming out of the factory. And, you know that what we were doing was totally different. It was going to be a medium-bodied stick. You know, most of the broadleaf sticks were, you know, medium four, full-bodied, you know, like Le Bijou and then all the Reserva stuff from Pete. But to use the Maduro wrapper, we wanted to use broadleaf Maduro. But we weren't in love with the first couple of blends, you know, that Pete was trying, and when we were down there and we were changing it up, I just kept barking about the, you know, the broadleaf, and I threw out, like, what if we use Sancti Spiritus in the blend? And Pete said that, you know, it might get lost a little bit, but we should try that. And I said, well, what if we use it in the binder wrapper? Because here, my tasting notes, so you know, are about Sancti Spiritus, is it just reminds me of the hayfield. So it's that grassy straw content, but, you know, out here in the east in the fall time, driving through the country, it's that kind of straw for me, that kind of hay. And, you know, and then broadleaf, chocolatey goodness, right? So I'm like, what about a binder leaf? We'd have chocolate-covered hay. That sounds gross. And Pete's like, that would either be absolutely horrible or brilliant. Let's try that before we try putting it in the filler. And we did. And when those samples came on the rolling table, it changed the broadleaf profile for me enough that I was like, I don't get chocolate forward. I get what I get when I get aged broadleaf. If I sit on a cigar that's broadleaf for a year, 2 years, that's kind of the way it did. It tamed it. And I think everybody liked it. But that was the moment where we were like, that would be a great marketing kick, you know, and a challenge for us going forward. Let's use Sancti Spiritus in everything that's Atelier branded. So it's not in all the, it's not in any of the surrogate blends right now. So that's, you know, that's different. That's project based. But in any of the Atelier blends up to and including Mission, it's somewhere. Right. Like Racine has it in the binder and the filler. And so this whole idea for Racine came out after that factory trip, and so we were already challenged to use it, and we said, well, let's use both, you know, put it in the binder and the filler both. The wrapper leaf on that's Criollo, by the way.
Okay, that was a question from Garen. I had to scroll through because there's so many questions. That was Garen's question. You were reading the questions beforehand? You were
cheating. Somehow I got on a link that I saw.
It's an actor.
When there were about six or seven questions, but the Lancero thing was already out there.
Oh, okay.
And as I was talking, I remembered that one was out there too.
You checked in early because there's a ton now. So I'm going to ask this follow-up question because it's topical. We're talking about the Racine, and have you guys announced what size you're doing for this year?
No.
Yeah, Sean.
We haven't put anything out there yet. We've hinted to a couple people, but haven't actually published what it is. I don't think we've ever published anything before. I think it's always been on the show.
You can always tell us now.
I've been telling everybody on the road, so anybody got a problem with Sean spilling the beans?
I don't.
No, Sean, you can, because it's been talked about. It was actually the precursor, or was it? It was supposed to be the one before this.
Yeah, it was. And we smoked this, what, over a year and a half ago, and then you decided you won the Lonsdale from last year. So it's a Robusto size this year.
Hmm. So it's a standard 5x50 Robusto?
No, it's I think it's 4 7/8 by 50.
4 7/8, huh?
Yeah.
I'm writing this down, so it better be true. I've already tweeted it out, by the way.
I can go back and check, but I'm pretty sure.
Somebody will find the information. They'll tweet it out too.
I'll find it right now.
Charlie's watching.
Yeah. Oh, maybe. You never know. They are on top of it.
Sean will find it.
Yeah, I've got it right. I'm pulling it up.
So now this will be the fifth size.
Fourth.
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 Yeah.
Okay. I haven't smoked the Lonsdale yet, and Lonsdale is basically like my go-to size, and even though I know it doesn't really work that way, but I tend to gravitate towards that size, so I'm going to have to check that out. I haven't smoked that one yet. I don't know if Logan still has any in the store. If he does, I'll have to get some. Let's see. We've lost Logan, by the way, so not exactly sure how long we've been going, but we'll try to figure it out.
Hey, before we jump in, before we move on, it is 4 7/8 by 50.
4 7/8 by 50.
That's probably the Cohiba size, right?
Yeah.
That's
all those sizes have been modeled after the a Cohiba size.
Okay. Okay.
Yep.
Okay. Yep. Okay, so we got another question from On, and this probably goes, I think this probably goes to Casper, you guys can all chime in. He wants to talk about Saints and Sinners a little bit. Whose idea was it to start the whole thing, and what's your favorite thing about it?
It was an idea that Pete had it was like end of 2010 or like middle of 2010. We were talking at the old office on Sunset, and you know, we were reminiscing about old band fan clubs, and I used to run a bunch of them for a record label years and years ago, and we were talking about how cool they were and that the music industry had something cool, but the cigar, the tobacco industry had nothing like that. So he thought about coming up with one and making it have the forum, you know, have a direct line to your customers, because back then social media was basically limited to Facebook. You know, there wasn't really much going on. Instagram wasn't huge. Twitter was big, but you didn't have that direct feel to the manufacturer. So yeah, it was definitely a conversation. We built the software and launched that next year. It was awesome.
So how do people join?
It opens up once a year to returning members that are current members of the year prior. They can renew in May, and then we make a limited number of spaces available in June to new members. So we started out at a small, you know, 100-something people the first year, and it's grown pretty significantly over the last 5 years. This is going to be year number 6 this year.
Okay. Now, is there a website that people go to sign up, or how does that work?
Yeah, it's just thesnsclub.com. Okay. If you go there, you can click to be notified when we open it up. And we've already pretty much let everybody know when those dates are, but if you're interested, you can look up emails and off the website, and they can get in touch, and we can give everybody the information. But back to the question, what's the best part of the club? I think it's the community that we've built. You know, it's these guys are a really diverse, cool group of people that, you know, yeah, you see Casey and Dan see a lot of them on the road. I don't get a chance to see many of them because I don't do nearly as much traveling as these guys, but you know, every time I go to an event like at Holtz or whatever, you know, they come out in droves, and they're some of the coolest people you'll ever meet. And it's a great community. That's what I love about it.
Yeah, it sounds like you're talking about Cigar Federation. It's a great community.
Yeah.
No, and it's tough. I mean, I've been a member of different communities online, and there's to have a good group. I mean, I feel like we've got a really good core of guys at Cigar Federation who. I don't want to say police it on their own, but you know, we've managed to avoid having the
you're about right. Right, they all self-police. There's one guy that really steps up and does it, and it's a unique situation when you can pull that all together like that. Yeah. It's pretty cool.
When your community takes that level of ownership,
yeah,
it's really really cool, and I think that is really cool when that happens. I'm going to keep scrolling through these questions here. I'm trying to read them as fast as I can because there's so many. So let's see. I'm going to throw this one at Casey. So over the past year or so, outside of test blends, what atelier have you been smoking most often?
Well, this past year, I'm a big Le Mission 1989. I enjoy that. The way that blend hits at that size. I'm pretty much, I'm going to say it's about 60% of what I've been smoking on the road, except for last week. I was with Dan. Smoke a lot of Tat, too. I smoke a lot of Pete's cigars on the road. I kind of bounce around between, but Le Mission 1989 is kind of my favorite of the bunch.
Yeah,
I know everybody... Hey, go ahead.
No, finish your thought.
No, I mean, everybody tends to go for that earthier, grittier taste in the 52, which is the 1959. I tend to lean the other way a little bit. It fits my flavor profile.
Yeah, that's a cigar that we were just talking about this. And I think it was we do a cigar chat once a month where it's just Logan and I, and maybe we'll have one of our other guys from the site will come on and talk. And we were talking about a cigar that... you know, the cigars that surprised you and what was something that you really liked over the last year, what let down, that kind of thing. And I remember when that cigar first came out, everybody loved it. But for me, it was a little bit too strong. I'm more of a, like, the original lat for me is, I love the cigar. So that profile for me, a little bit more, I don't want to say delicate, but nuance is kind of what Logan said, although there's a ton of nuance with the La Mission. But I've been smoking that a lot more in the last, like, 6 months. Such a good cigar. It's a phenomenal cigar. And I need to try more of the different sizes. I'm not sure which size it is that I've been smoking, to be honest. But
The 54 just hits my palate. And, you know, when we came back from the first run of test blends, I think I nubbed the 54 right down to nothing. I was content. It was one of those smokes where you just sat there and went, oh,
That was yeah. I was content. I like that.
Yeah, I was just in a good spot. So
you were having a Zen moment.
I really was. Totally.
You found your center and your happy place and all that.
So I travel with Dan a lot. So you know that having to happen.
Rob. Well,
yeah.
Your cigar, it's coming up.
Which one?
Give us a month.
In
about a month, there'll be another size of La Mission called the 1955. Mm-hmm. Six and three quarter by 44 box press.
Ooh.
Boom. Yeah.
When's that coming out?
About a month.
About a month.
Yeah, I'm gonna have to. I'll keep my eyes out for that. What year is that one gonna be?
1955.
Now, whenever I hear years like the 50s. I always think of baseball, and I'm trying to think, who won the World Series in 55? And off the top of my head, I can't think. It's probably the Yankees, but I can't
think. Yankees, Dodgers, let me see.
Okay, yeah, it's always a safe guess.
Somebody
always,
will look it up.
Always a safe guess to say the Yankees. There was a question here I was just going to ask. Where did it go? It had to do with the names that you guys come up with. here we go. This is from Marty Messina. And I guess we can kind of just throw it at the group, and whoever wants to answer, jump in. Where do you guys draw the ideas for your names, especially among the surrogates line? Those are some of the most unique names in the business. So, Marty's giving you a compliment and asking a question.
Sean?
Oh, Dan, go for it. You want to know specifically about surrogates.
Let me talk about the Atelier names first.
Yeah, okay.
Atelier means the workshop in French. So a lot of the that love of wine comes in with all the other stuff that we've done, La Mission, the mission, and although Extension de la Racine is Spanish, yes, Sean.
Yeah. Yeah.
So I was trying to avoid the surrogate's name question.
Sorry, Dayton, you have to fess up.
Yeah, no. So the surrogate's names, I think I alluded to it a little bit earlier. They always come about while drinking.
The love of wine.
Or anything, yeah. Drinking in general usually spawns creativity. And one thing will lead to another, and even if we're not together, one of us will text each other, hey, how about surrogates, blankety blank? More often than not, we might know what we're, joking about when we do that. The names have two, three times removed a kind of a hidden joke. We don't usually dispel much about, but they all talk about the experience of what that cigar is either paying homage to or that style of cigar. If I gave you an example, you'd probably figure out more of them, but I don't really want to give even one of the examples.
Fair enough.
As to not offend anyone in the industry.
Sure.
Although most of the people in the industry that are there like, oh yeah, that's me, isn't it? We're like, yeah, how do you figure that out?
Or can you make one about me?
Yeah, that's what I was gonna say. Matt Booth, he keeps going, when are you gonna do me? When are you gonna do? And we have one. We have one in the thought process.
In the world.
That would have nothing to do with trying to create a Booth style 101 room 101 cigar, but the name would, kind of play at that a little bit. Well, here, Tramp Stamp. Tramp Stamp is obviously a play on Tatuaje, right? Meaning tattoo. We bounced through a bunch of different names because we had Bone Crusher and Skullbreaker at the get-go. And then we wanted two more when we came in to our first trade show. So there would be four in the portfolio going national. So Pete's like, you got to do me. And I'm like, all right, then we got to do a Corona Gorda. So we kind of played off of the Corona Gorda Black Label. The experience of Tramp Stamp is kind of the experience of Tatuaje Black. The blend surely isn't. It's just in that wheelhouse. We were talking about, things being in a wheelhouse. So, hey, what do you normally smoke? okay, that gives me a clue of what your wheelhouse is. And so Tramp Stamp is in the wheelhouse of Tatuaje Black. Different flavor profile, different wrapper, the whole shoot match. But we wanted to use that size specifically because Corona Gorda, going back to the beginning with Pete, was a thing that he did, his favorite size, and he had them roll things for him at that size. You know, so that whole event stick culture that seems like everybody and the brother has now copied at the Corona Gorda size, also my favorite size, kind of started about 13 years ago when Pete had them roll, yeah, Corona Gordas for him. So we, of course, had to use that size. And so some of the others have been like that. It either comes from myself smoking a lot of something else and going, wow, I wish we could use our tobacco and do something in that same style. Crystal Baller was that. I was smoking a lot of something that was a very finessed stick and happened to be box-pressed, and I'm like, I want my own box-pressed chunky, so let's use our tobacco and do that. And then the name is about three times removed from the inside joke, but I won't spill that.
It sounds like you guys have a lot of fun working together.
We absolutely do.
I mean, obviously you all work very closely together, but you're all in very different parts of the country.
Yep.
Is there a lot of Skype happening, or you guys spend a lot of time together, obviously.
We're all about 1-3 a.m. on the East Coast text from Pete. I said it. There I did. I threw my brother under the bus. Now we're all pretty close. We text each other constantly. We're in communication. I talk to Casper about at least five times a day. And Dan and I have a morning ritual while everybody's still sleeping on the West Coast. and we talk. Pete's in constant contact with us. I mean, it's a unique group, but it works. I don't know if anybody mentioned it earlier on in the conversation. We're forming a band, and we all have parts to it, and we do very, very well, I think. But
who's the drummer?
Sean. Sean, you said you're the drummer.
According to that Cigar Press article, that was my piece.
You're the drummer. The drummer keeps everybody in line.
Yeah.
At least that's the way I see it.
I tell everybody, he's our logistics guy. He makes everything happen. He was schooled in it when he was working with rock bands, and now he's doing the same thing. You know, for us, he's home base. Who is the guy that used to beam everybody down in Star Trek? Was it Scotty? There you go. He's Scotty for us. So keeps everything in order.
You've got to have one. You've got to have a Scotty. Speaking of, so keeping everything in order, kind of organizing everything, getting ready for events that are coming up. The obligatory IPCPR questions are coming, so prepare yourselves.
Okay.
These are mainly for Sean here. So what are you most, and actually this could be for the whole group, what are you most excited about for IPCPR this year?
Me, personally?
Yeah, what are you most excited about, and what are you dreading the most?
The thing that I'm most excited about is we are debuting a brand new booth. This is the first time that we have had something that, you know, was really, really a lot. We poured everything, we had into this. Like, Pete has toiled over all the smallest little details on this thing, and when people see it, they're gonna be able to tell how much time was dumped into this thing because it's gorgeous. So that's the thing I'm most excited about.
And the thing you're dreading the most is putting it together?
No, making sure it gets put together right.
Like, no, dude, I'm not putting it together. Somebody else is doing that. But
we have a company doing that, but the fact I just hope to God that what we see is what's actually going to show up, because it's so awesome, man. This booth is going to be really incredible. It's next level, that's for sure.
Next level. All right. So I'm not going to ask too many questions. I like the setup that you guys have had. I've always felt like there's two different ways as far as IPCPR booths can go, where you just kind of go really over the top, And, you know, some companies like Drew Estate, their booth is always over the top. Or you can go with that tight, classic look like Padron. And their look is always, as far as I've been to, this will be my fourth IPCPR, I believe, or fifth. Not sure. Yeah. But their booth's always the same, and it's always clean, and it's always tight. And you guys have had the same booth, I think, every time that I've been there, too. And it's clean. It's got that tight look. It almost feels like you're walking into like a high-end jewelry store, in a way. Yeah.
All I'm going to say is that you've never seen something with Pete's style on his own, and this is the time you're going to see it. This is his style to the T.
So are we actually going to be able to get tattoos in the booth? Or?
No, sir.
No.
Not happening.
I don't even want to know what the insurance issue would be with that.
Sure, I think that's a great idea because Mom and Dad are going this year again. Oh, yeah. So, yeah, why not? Come on, Mom and Dad can get a tattoo like their son. Perfect.
Oh, that's too funny. Guys, you're listening to Cigar Chat, brought to you live on CigarFederation.com. Broadcast around the world in the Armed Forces Radio Network. We're here with the guys from Atelier and Surrogates talking about a little bit of everything. We've got about 10 minutes left, so I'm going to keep scrolling through. One thing I'm going to chime in, even though I'm done with my pairing here, but I was pairing the original the Lat Classic or whatever it is that we were calling it with Allagash White, and this was a very good pairing for me.
Nice.
I know Casper. I know you like the craft beer, and Allagash is still a craft beer, right?
Yeah, kind of.
For the most part. In Maine, it's not.
Anybody know that one?
Of course. I can't see which one it is on the bottom, though.
It's Deliverance.
Deliverance. Wow.
I haven't had that one.
I'll send you one.
Oh, my God. Yeah, you got to find that.
I'll
send you a couple bottles.
It's their Imperial Stout barrel-aged and their Barley Wine barrel-aged mixed together.
Sounds nice and light. Wow. What is that, like a 13%?
But it was going with the Animal Cracker AC550, so boom.
I can imagine. I can't wait to smoke that.
It's a malt bomb, that's for sure.
And that's really fun, too. The Bell's 30th anniversary.
Mm-hmm. Oh, nice.
A one-off that Bell's did. Yeah, you probably don't get that out there.
We don't get a lot of Bell's out here. I had to track down some Hop Slam myself. I only had one, but it was worth it. It was really good.
It's good. It's not like, hey, go stand in line good.
No, we talked about this a little bit. We're going to get off track, but the only time I've ever stood in line and waited for beer was last month. Yeah. And they had Pliny the Younger at my local tap room. And I debated as well whether I wanted to do it or you know, they were only going to have one keg. So I started doing beer math, right? I mean, that's 2 8-ounce pours per person. Well, how many ounces are in a keg? And they're not going to be able to get it all, so it's only like 100 people are going to get tickets. So I'm going through all this in my head, and I'm thinking, okay, well, and they open at 11. They're not tapping it until 2. So it's like an all-day thing. And I met with a buddy of mine, June, who does our What Embargo show, and we got there at 8 o'clock. Thinking that it's either going to be, it's too late, or it's going to be too early. We got there at 8 o'clock, and there was not one person there. Nobody in line. So I went home, and I was playing some PlayStation or something, and I came back. And it turned out that that June actually stayed the whole time. So we were the first person in line, or first people. And, you know, it was good, but nothing is worth waiting 5 hours for.
No, not at all.
Okay. You know? Okay, so here's my soapbox, because you said we were going to get off track, right?
Why not?
I don't think we're off track at all, because the analogy into our world of cigars is exactly the same.
Sure.
Do you see that? You feel that? I feel like, you know, that whole limited edition craze, which, you know, we're all a part of from both sides, of, you know, from both companies as well. I don't know. Like you said.
It has its place.
There are things that are worth chasing, and then there are things that are fun if you get it in the chase. But my big soapbox is, man, we create great stuff, and so do so many other companies create so many great things that are meant to smoke, be in your daily rotation, you know, kind of, you know, we talk on the road all the time with retailers, and they're like, you know, that guy, that guy that used to be a one brand kind of guy, or, you know, hey, I smoke Ashton, or I smoke this, or I'm just a Padron guy, they're going by the wayside. Mm-hmm. And part of it, you know, in my opinion, part of it is that there are so many good cigars on the market that, you know, you do want to try a bunch of things. There are a lot of newer guys, you know, in the hobby, and like we all did, you make your way through all the things that are on the market. But when you get caught in, I only want to smoke things that, you know, are limited, or, you know, someone else can't get their hands on. I was that guy for about a year with craft beer, and that was recent. That was like 3 years ago, and it kind of hit me like, yeah, I don't need any of this stuff. There's a lot of stuff that I love that I'm just gonna go back to drinking when I want to drink it, I didn't understand it from the cigar side, you know, that guys were like that, and I'm like, well, I'm that guy with beer, so the analogy is a direct analogy into a, you know, between the two worlds, but the same thing. There's a lot of really good beer being made, and, you know, and then you got a bunch of guys that are getting bought out by Anheuser because they're creating nice crafty things, and now all of a sudden they're Anheuser, and people are like, I don't want that because it's part of Anheuser, like Goose Island. I'm like, Goose Island's a great beer. Is it worth chasing? I don't know. And do you have a different attitude about chasing it now because it's, you know, owned by Anheuser-Busch? You know, I don't know. There's a lot of food for thought for all the listeners. That'd be a great topic to just open up as a, you know, a blog entry and let people spill out about, because we talk about it, I swear, every trip I take, you know, retailers will talk about it, and we talk about it, and, you know, it's one of the things with Atelier, and, you know, we busted it right away by creating Extension de la Racine as kind of a limited, is that we set off not to do that. You know, that surrogate's model of, you know, stop saving this stuff. I did it. Stop saving this stuff.
I appreciate it. Thank
smoke
you.
It. You know, and we actually had a little ad that said, stop chasing, start smoking, you know, and it showed all the surrogates bands. And I'm like, that's what that brand was all about. But even more so, Atelier Imports was all about creating the best stuff that we could and show off how good we could create something, how well we could create something. My grammar's gone. With the blessed Garcia tobacco that we're blessed to use, and who would be wanting to call me political telemarketers?
yes,
that's who. At a consumer conscious price point, I swear this was like the most hokey advertising term that I came up with, but it was consumer conscious, and I'm like, but it's true. We just decided we wouldn't try to create anything that was over $10 a stick, and if we wanted something that Pete was more like, yeah, that's going to cost us, we were just going to eat it. And the only exception to that has been a very, very special project of ours called Cote d'Or, which was last year. Sean, you want to talk about this year's Cote d'Or and what's different about it? I've been talking so much, but
we'll just
out there to the group.
And it's perfect timing because the Latoche is the new one. It's Cote d'Or Latoche that's coming out this year, but it's getting ready to come out. I think they're going to be arriving in stores sometime in April or end of April.
Oh, wow.
Which is great. And it's a totally different size. It's a Robusto size, and it's round this time. So still using the Papin Palo de Oro, but in a totally different size. Still 10-count box, same price, $16 retail. It's a beautiful cigar. We smoked it just recently, the final production stuff, when these guys were out in L.A. A couple of weeks ago, and it's so awesome. I'm really excited for that to come out.
And one other big difference.
Rosado wrapper.
Yeah. The different color wrapper, and then the box and band are also very different. So it's a burgundy color box with a Casey... threw his hat in the ring and came up with the idea of making the leaf, the box inside the leaf on the center of the band burgundy colored as well. So it just came out looking beautiful.
Yeah, the wrapper part is a big thing, and we were talking about that early on in this discussion about the SS versus the original Atelier. This is in between. Yeah, we call it, it's the Rosado sorting. It definitely has a reddish hue to it, and it literally is in between. Every once in a while, I'll open up a box of Atelier that might be closer to Rosado, but you know, Rosado's right in the middle of what our SS wrapper is and what the, you know, the normal average lighter Atelier wrapper is. And you know, as much as I loved Cote d'Or last year and stood on a soapbox about, you know, I don't know what cigar has, you know, blown me away like that in years and years and years, I actually like this year's better because I think the Rosado wrapper, again, lets more of the flavor come through without being coated by the, you know, the darker SS wrapper.
Absolutely.
And that takes absolutely nothing away from last year's because, you know, it helped that last year was a Churchill with the darker wrapper because it let more finesse come through. It started off cooler in my, you know, it would be my tasting notes. And then, you know, this year, 5.5x50 Robusto, actually. You know, it's the flavor profile is a little more in your face, and you really get right out of the box. You really get a little bit more of what Pella d'Oro was, a, you know, the flavor profile of it, not what it's about, but the flavor profile of Pella d'Oro. Last year's Cote d'Or, you know, was basically an SS in a Churchill with the Garcia's Pella d'Oro inside, and like magic just happened. I mean, it was crazy how different that cigar is with, you know, half a leaf of something pulled out and half a leaf of Pella d'Oro put in. But, you know, we're still using that same amount of Pella d'Oro in the 5.5x50 round, but the Rosado wrapper just lets that flavor profile come through so much more. And it's, you know, there's a sweetness that I think got lost with that, you know, a little bit more toasted flavor of the SS wrapper. It obviously added to that mix, and then it adds to this other mix in a different way. But you might actually get more of a, you know, a real true piece of what Pella d'Oro would taste like on its own.
Cool. Well, we're going to look forward to that. Guys, you've given us a ton of information. We're at the end of our Armed Forces Radio segment. So I want to thank you guys for hanging out with us. Thank you for not having us or not making us do any post-production editing. I appreciate that. We're really close at the end, but appreciate it, guys. Thanks so much. Everybody out there in the Armed Forces listening, thank you so much for everything that you do. As I say every week, you guys are built to do something that I'm not built to do, so thank you for putting your personal safety on the line to fight for our freedoms around the world. I hope you were able to hang out with us for an hour and relax and hopefully have a cigar.
Cheers, James. Thank you.
Cheers to that.
Yeah, absolutely. Guys, we'll be back next week. We'll be back on Thursday next week, so... you can tune in at CigarFederation.com. Thanks so much. We'll be back, like I said, next week, next Thursday. Guys, thanks for hanging out with us. You can find us at CigarFederation.com. Everybody have a great week and stay safe.
Cheers, guys.
Sweet. Thanks, Rob.
Thank you.
Okay, and so that's the end of our Armed Forces Radio segment. We're still live, and this will still be on our podcast. But now you can say shit if you feel like saying shit. thank you for not saying it before. I appreciate that.
CQ zero
for Dan. That's amazing.
Oh, I saw the bomb. I saw a prairie bomb.
Which one is that? Was that the Christmas?
No, he had a Bible belt.
Bible belt.
Oh, I haven't even seen that.
Oh, you gotta get that. It's like, you know, prairie bomb.
Yeah, I haven't seen that one. It's okay. I'll have to look for that.
This is one of those that you go into a store and they give you two. We're in a grocery store in Dallas.
Max.
You can have two.
Max.
So,
two.
So I'm waiting for Pete to buy a pallet, right? No, I'm just kidding.
You know, I like the prairie stuff. I mean, it's hit or miss for me. But, I mean, the prairie bomb obviously is awesome.
Yep.
And I had the Christmas bomb this year, but they had the new label on it. Didn't have the Home Alone kid anymore, you know?
Yeah.
And I didn't like it.
I didn't see this year. I liked last year's. I didn't see this year's.
It's just a green label. I don't know. There's different stuff. You know, they do the dark cartoons or whatever on the labels. But I noticed it didn't have the Home Alone kit on there, and I don't know if they changed it or what, but it just didn't taste right to me. Yeah. I had a couple of them.
Christmas is tough because it's like the whole kitchen sink of spice rack.
Yeah.
And honestly, I used to get the one from San Francisco, Anchor Christmas, mm-hmm. which, you know, it's pretty spiced, but it's subtly spiced. But I used to get a case. This is back in the 90s when I was homebrewing. I'd get a case, and we'd drink four of them over Christmas holidays, and then the rest of it just sat there. And then the next year we'd get a case, and we'd drink four of them, and then we'd open up a couple from the year before and a couple of this, you know. And we got to, you know, 4 or 5 years worth of vertical, and I'm like, okay, for me, that beer is meant to be drank about 5 years later. In fact, I had one about 15 years after I bought it, and it was still, like, phenomenal.
Interesting.
Yeah, but fresh out of the bottle, I mean, that and pumpkin beers, man, there are just so many of them.
I do another website with my wife. And I've been doing some beer reviews and things like that. She does recipes and whatnot. And my search for the perfect pumpkin ale. And I must have gone through 25 different pumpkin beers. And I guess got so sick of them by the end. But they all taste the same.
They do. I like it when there's a little bit of spice. But when they taste like pumpkin, it's too much, yeah. I just want the little bit of spices that are in there that hint at it. It's like pumpkin ice cream. Like, I can't stand it unless there's just a hint of it, and then I love it. Because I love all things pumpkin.
Yeah, but I can do the pumpkin.
I'm sick of pumpkin beers. Totally sick of them.
As I was going through, and I go back and I look at my reviews, the ones that were the least like a pumpkin ale were the ones I liked the most.
Yeah.
Right. Yeah.
There was a barrel aged version from Anderson Valley, the Jeeky Pinch Barrel, or they have weird names for it. But the bourbon barrel aged version was really, really good because it didn't taste like a pumpkin beer. It just had some of that spice to it.
Right.
And I heard you say home brewing. I'm like neck deep in home brewing right now, and I won't bring it up because we'll derail. But I was this close to we'll derail even more. I was this close to pairing this lat with a brown ale, the first beer that I have bottled. I've only bottled my second batch. This is my first batch. But I didn't want to do that to myself because it's so bad. They tell you that if you can make macaroni and cheese from a box, then you can make beer. It's not really true. I mean, yeah, I think you could technically call what I made beer, but woof.
Yeah. It's changed a lot now, man. You can get, you know, whole grain systems for a dime that, like, you know, rival a real brewery. That would be the thing that would get me back in the game, would be doing something where I'm really going full whole grain without the pain that we used to go through to do whole grain.
I just bought an all grain system.
You did, see?
From a guy on Craigslist, and it's just the big coolers, you know, the 10-gallon coolers like you get from Home Depot, and he fitted them with the false bottom and all that.
Yep.
And you really could put a system together relatively cheaply, but I haven't done one yet. I was supposed to brew this past weekend, but it didn't work out. I'm just gonna do for my first all grain. I'm doing a simple smash, just two-row pale malt and galaxy hops. That's it. Just for a pale ale. Just keep it real simple. Hopefully it tastes like beer. We'll see. The jury is still out. So we've got some giveaways that we're going to do, and I know everybody's waiting. Logan, I don't know if you guys noticed, Logan dropped off like 45 minutes ago. It was like 20 minutes before I realized he was gone. He sent me a text message, and it's, you know, it's nothing personal to Logan, but...
he was offended by our love of the natural salty spirituous pepper.
Yeah, absolutely. And he was having some internet issues. So I'm going to go ahead. I'm going to select two winners that I picked based on their questions. Logan's going to pick four winners at random tonight. And then we're going to have two podcast winners and two AFRN listeners. winners. So you guys all know the drill. You have to email Logan. But I'm going to tell you the two winners that I picked tonight for the questions that they asked. Garen, you're a winner. And Jose, you guys are the two winners tonight. Email Logan at Cigar Federation with and put winner in the subject line because – and don't everybody do that because we already know –
I was just going to tell everybody to do that.
No. We know that the two winners – we know who they are. So if you put winner in your subject line and you're not a winner, then you're not going to win. Everybody else, email Logan at CigarFederation.com with Atelier Cigar Chat in the subject line. In the body of the email, put your name, mailing address, and a statement saying that you're of legal age to purchase tobacco in your jurisdiction. And I don't know if he'll email you back, or maybe just a package will show up one day and you won't even be expecting it, and you'll just figure out that you were a winner. But I know we've got some ashtrays, we've got some hats, some really cool gear to give away, so some fun stuff for you guys. Let me see if I can get this back on track with cigars and keep you guys here for a little bit, because there's so many questions here. Let's see. A lot of this stuff is kind of, we're kind of going over what we did already. Upcoming La Mission, we already touched on that. Oh, here's one. This one's from Mike Hanna, and this is specifically for you, Dan, while you fire up over there. He wants to know if there are any new blends for the NHC line coming out anytime soon. Or anything?
No.
No, simple answer.
Yeah, no.
So that's kind of, that's reached its course, huh?
Well, the way the NHC cigar came about was, you know, a blatant accident, in that there were a bunch of boxes sitting around from the Varicu and Black Tubos release. Mm-hmm. That Pete texted me from the factory one time and said, "Dude, I've got this awesome idea. We've got these boxes." Is that good, Casey?
Yeah, wow. What just happened over there?
Oh, you poured bourbon, didn't you?
No, rye. Whistle Pig.
Oh, nice.
I came this close to buying a bottle of that at Costco today.
Did you? How much was it there?
62.
Yeah, this is 45 for...
That's a smaller bottle, though, isn't it?
Yeah, it is a tiny bottle. What is it? I don't even see the middle. It's brutal.
I figured either it was a smaller bottle or you're a giant.
3.7, yeah.
That's a 375?
Yeah.
Oh, damn.
$45.
Wow.
Crazy.
Yeah, that's a chaser.
Yeah.
Sean went and got a drink, too, didn't you?
No, I didn't. I had to get up and... Oh, nice. That's what I was drinking last time.
Whistle Pig? Yeah.
Yeah, the Boss Hog is what I had last time we did the show.
Well, aren't we special at $179 a bottle?
It was a gift.
Good for you. In all terms, I'm keeping it PG. Good for you.
I just caught that.
Snarky.
Mr. CQ.
Yeah, exactly.
You guys don't even need me here. You don't even. I can just drop off, and you guys can just keep going.
How about this?
You Chuck have to Quinlan. Ask questions.
What? Chuck Quinlan. Chuck Quinlan. CQ, Chuck Quinlan.
Yeah, exactly. This is
what were we talking about?
We were talking about the NHC.
So no more NHCs. The NHC project, you know, in those original boxes, you know, was a really cool thing. We do want to redo them, but, you know, there's kind of a hiatus on the whole, shop exclusive thing, which that kind of falls into. Unless Pete's listening and he wants to let me just order them straight from the factory.
CQ!
Hey, Chuck.
Wow.
Yeah, I'm playing along. I'm only keeping up with, like, maybe 10% of what you guys are saying. But
it's that's enough.
So I had to grab myself another drink. Casper, have you had any of the stuff here from Modern Times?
Yeah. They make a couple of really cool things. Like, they're some of the stuff I haven't really liked, but they make a few things that I think are worth checking out.
This is the
first. I love the packaging. The packaging is awesome.
Yeah, it has that really cool kind of old school look to it. This is the first time I've had the devil's teeth, though.
Yeah.
Which sounds very aggressive.
It's good. It's not as aggressive as the name. It's good, though.
Have you had the City of the Dead?
Yes.
That's phenomenal.
Yeah, that's a great beer.
I thought it was phenomenal. That's one of the best coffee stouts I think I've ever had.
Yeah.
That was phenomenal. And I actually stocked up on that a little bit, probably a little too much. But anyway, so I'm going to crack this open here. But yeah, the beer fridge back there is pretty full. Hey, this is perfectly on topic here, and this is another one from Jose. Jose, this is why you were a big winner tonight. This is a question for the whole crew. If you were offered your choice of top shelf scotch, bourbon, wine, or craft beer, what would you reach for? Think about it. You guys think about it. I'm going to try to get this bottle open without hurting myself.
If it's top shelf, it's wine all the way, because top shelf wine is going to be way more expensive.
So, I don't know, Dan. I had the bottle of a taste of a Oban 21 that Judd brought. It was $3,200. It was ridiculous. I paired it with an HC Maduro. Sorry, Dan.
HCS Maduro.
Maduro and a little espresso on the side, and it was just a heavenly trifecta. So I think I'd go with the Oban 21. That experience was just unbelievable.
Oban 21.
I would go with the wine, because that would be a sensory experience that I'm not going to get otherwise. Mm-hmm. The high end.
An aristocrat.
I think I'd probably go. I'm torn, man. I drink a lot of bourbon. I drink a lot of craft beer. So for me, it would be, you know, a flip of the coin for me. It'd be one or the other. When you guys were out in December, we drank that bottle of Lost Prophet with
Pete.
That was pretty awesome.
Yep.
So I think that might have topped every craft beer I've ever had in my life. So, and I've had a lot.
Yeah. Yeah, but props to Sean. Sean got me a bottle of First Growth Bordeaux of my birth year. Wow. We won't even say how old that was, but it was 50 years old when I drank it. And it was insane. So that's my wine experience of a lifetime right now, was that bottle. So, you know, of course that would not be on just a regular top shelf, but, you know.
It's a mythical top shelf. It can have whatever you want.
Well then, see, that's why I'm right there, because of that bottle and you know, older wines, for some reason, it's a whole nother realm. Like to say you had this great wine is one thing, but to have it after it's aged so many years, it's a whole nother experience. it's almost a different category.
Mm-hmm. Huh. Yeah, I don't know. I would probably. For me, it would probably be scotch, and I don't know. I don't have a specific scotch in mind. I think of high end scotch for me is like a bottle that's going to put me back about $1.50. That's about as high as my high end goes. So that's probably where I'd go. I mean, I've had some high end wine. My wife, and I talk about my wife a lot on the show, which I guess is a good thing.
That is a good thing.
she works for a family of high net worth and puts together events for them and things, and they actually grow grapes in Sonoma. So they do a lot of events like that, and she'll come home with a bottle of wine here and there that was, you know, maybe it was half empty and nobody finished it, so she brought it home, kind of thing. And we end up with some strange things, like Screaming Eagle is the one that I can remember, and there's been some Harlan wines and things like that, which are phenomenal, but my palate doesn't really recognize all of that, maybe. It's wasted on me a little bit, I guess you'd say. It is a nice experience. She brought home some cognac one time, and it was like a 40-year-old cognac or something like that. And it was, I don't remember what it was, because she didn't have it in a bottle. She put it in like a little, like a shot glass kind of, and wrapped it up with all of this plastic wrap so it wouldn't spill. And it was probably one of the smoothest, sweetest things I've ever tasted, but I can't remember what it was, so it doesn't really make for much of a story, but it was quite good. But yeah, probably scotch for me, I would think.
Cool.
That would be my thought. Let's see. Go down a couple of questions, and I'll let you guys get out of here. Let's see. Oh, this is an interesting question. This one's from Shooter here. And he says, in general, is it easier or do you think it makes it more difficult to make decisions concerning your brand as a group?
I think it's way better than other things I've done where you're making decisions on your own. We have a sounding board, you know. There's always going to be, you know, opposition and a voice of reason at some point in our group. So, and I feel like every time we make a decision, we always land on something that we're all happy with and something that makes sense for who we are as a company. I think that's just
right.
That's the best part of it.
I think it's probably more difficult, but it's more of what we want as a whole. I think if we made an easy decision, any single one of us, it might be okay. But this is the battle. It's competitive. It works. And the juices are always flowing.
Yeah, I agree. And, you know, I'm not the guy that's going to pat you on your back and say, awesome, man. Everything you do is awesome. So I'm devil's advocate. Everybody needs a devil's advocate, right? And
all right, if there's anybody that's a pain in the ass in the group, it's that guy.
That's me. That's my job, though. That's what makes it good. You know, if we had four guys that were just like kind of following one, and you could put that together easily, right? You know, we would all be like, oh, yeah, that's awesome. And we're not that. We're none of us are that guy. I might be the most antagonistic in the realm of, yeah, but what about this or what about that? But in the long run, we make the best decision because there are four really disparate personalities. Right. The only hard part is that we're separated. You know, we don't all go into the same office on a daily basis. That makes it a little harder. But you know, back to an analogy, the best grapes grow on rocky slopes that, you know, where they can't get the nourishment that they really need. So a little bit of that and a lot of ideas go a long way. So yeah, I wouldn't trade it. I mean, I surely wouldn't want to be making the decisions all myself because I would question all of them. And when you know, and if I had three guys that were following everything that I wanted to do, I hate that. I'd rather, you know, when Logan was here and he was like, you know, that cigar is just not for me, I have ultimate respect for that. That's what I want. And it's not to try to convince him of that. It's because I know that that's, you know, there are a lot of people that a certain cigar doesn't fit for.
Which one did he say?
No, he's more of a fan of the SS than he is right. The regular Atelier.
Yeah, that makes sense.
We started off with that whole conversation, and trust me, we get it, you know? I mean, we create cigars that we want to smoke, and we just hope that you want to smoke them. I mean, that's the bottom line. I mean, that's our Cheers, best brother. Line. Yeah, that's what we do. So I don't want to try to convince you that it's a better cigar. It's just better for my palate. You know, we had Pete do that ad, the best cigar is the one in your hand on purpose. Mm-hmm. That's what we all believe that. Wholeheartedly believe that. So
this is kind of a follow-up question, actually, and a kind of an accidental follow-up, really, from Eric Johnson. And he references, you know, Atelier has garnered a lot of success, you know, since day one, really, a lot of awards, high ratings, things of that nature, and some much-anticipated cigar releases. Do you guys feel the pressure to continue to produce outstanding blends, and how has that success influenced the growth of Atelier in general? Hmm. Am I saying it right? It's Atelier, right?
Yeah. Atelier.
Yeah. You don't really pronounce the L.
You don't really pronounce it. You can put a little more emphasis on the A, like Atelier. Oh. But yeah, you're right. You're right on.
When I have sales reps that can't pronounce it, you're doing a great job.
It's better than Latelier and Latantlers.
Latantlers.
Down south, it's Latantlers, and Latelier is pretty common. But so is Cajunu or Cohanu. I don't know if any of us have ever spoke about any kind of pressure. I mean, I think we're all humbled by, you know, the accolades and the ratings and whatnot. But it really is, you said it, it's a follow-up question. Yeah. It really does go with what we were just saying.
Yeah.
You know, when you have disparate minds together trying to create something, and I'm telling you, man, every one of us has a bit of type A about us where we just... Yeah. The perfectionist in us is silly. Casey said something earlier about, you know, it's usually midnight or 3 a.m. on the East Coast. I was up with Pete on my laptop, on my porch, literally at 3 a.m., finishing up about 4 a.m. when we were doing the original Atelier, the word Atelier, as a logo. And he was throwing me AI files, and I'm bringing them up, and I'm going, you know what? I don't like the way the apostrophe falls because the A is just a little bit, oh, yeah, you're right. I knew it. I was right there with you. You know, and we were going back and forth. We're on the phone, and we're sending stuff back and forth through our computers, and I'm like, I got off, and I couldn't sleep for another 2 hours because I was so jazzed that someone else was that specific about something so small.
Did you say yeah. jazzed?
Jazzed. I was jazzed, bro.
Damn, cut that out.
But, you know, you look, and you like, you take a font, right? And you spell something out, and you're like, that looks cool.
Yeah. Yeah,
that's not good enough. It was never good enough with Pete. Pete's always done this. And I've always done it with everything in my life, and so have Casey and Sean in other realms. I mean, we all have those experiences of being perfectionists. And we throw it all into that same realm. I mean, it can be the most minute thing, like move the apostrophe a couple pixels over, and then when you do that, then the A is too far away, so move the A further over.
Getting back to the question, we're all so competitive in what we do, and the industry sets standards constantly. The benchmarks are here and here. I mean, because we are in a golden age of cigars and everybody's putting out great blends, we don't always see the benchmark put up by other people, but we hold ourselves to a big benchmark. So, and Pete has always with his cigars. So I honestly think to answer the first, is it what my brother's name? What was his name? He was a Johnson, right? Who asked the question?
Eric.
Eric Johnson, yeah.
Well, it's S-E-N, but close enough.
Oh, okay. But no, honestly, we are so competitive in what we do. We want to put out amazing product every time, and we work hard at it as a group. So getting back to what he said, I think we do set a benchmark for ourselves, and we're always trying to not beat ourselves, but put out a quality product for the consumer that we like.
Yeah.
Yeah, without feeling the pressure of it, though.
Yeah, there's no pressure. None of us have ever
talked about that, because it still goes back to we want to create the best thing for ourselves, you know, and without the market pressure of, you know, trying to one-up whatever. I mean, you know, to be blunt, La Mission is a huge success. We didn't set out with blending La Mission to make it be like better than everything else that we've done, and I don't feel that it's better, but it's an amazing cigar. But everything came together, the packaging, the Pete's idea to change, you know, the branding and do its own kind of band, and then the back and forth with the band, and we had people outside the four of us involved with trying to create that band. And you know, we actually have a really funny quote between all of us when we're talking about design elements and moving something over a notch. But I won't up my CQ value by spilling it. Sean can say it. He's in LA. Go ahead, tell him what that
moving things in Conte?
Yeah. Yeah.
That's always there, man. That's in every design aspect. It's, you know, we got to move that just tiny bit. Oh, you mean a cut hair? Yeah.
Yeah.
That might be actually a unit of value now. Like, you might actually be able to like choose that in Photoshop and Illustrator.
It should be because we dubbed it.
You know, it's funny. I my day job is graphic design. That's what I do for a living. One of my many jobs. And soon I will be the I already talked to Pete about this. I'm going to be the master brewer for Tatuaje Brewing. So, just so you guys know, we're about 2 years out maybe, but it's going to happen.
You're moving to Maine, huh?
What's that?
You're moving to Maine then, huh?
Sure. If that's what it takes. It's warm up there, right?
Yeah, right.
Yeah, I don't think so.
Cheers.
Yeah, I don't know how a Bay Area boy would do up there.
Not well.
I get some frost. You're on spoiled. The patio. Little frost on the patio. That's about it.
Yeah.
The reason I brought that up was I wish I had clients that said things like that. Just move it.
Yeah.
And Logan would have loved that, by the way.
Go ahead, say it. Go ahead. Your client would want you to say, go ahead, move it up.
Just move it over just a little cunt hair, just a little bit.
There you go. Awesome.
I, you know what? I guarantee you, Logan could never get me to say that on the show. But, you know, this is, let's see, what is this? What's the percentage on this? Oh, it's only 10%. That's not an excuse. Okay, just a couple more questions, and then we'll be done.
Okay.
This one, it's not an Atelier question, but a lot of people are asking, when are the Skinny Monsters going to be shipping? And I know we were talking about this a little bit offline. Anybody?
I think the first production
is pretty
soon. Yeah,
soon. I don't know a date. I don't know anything like that, but I think they're it's sooner than later.
Okay, fair enough. That was I know that's not really under your guys' umbrella, but a lot of people were asking, so.
Yeah. It's about 3 weeks away. It's around that realm. Around tax day, probably.
Tax day.
We have another scoop about that if you want it.
We always want the scoop.
I mean, you might have heard it already, but.
What do you got?
Guys, that's public, right?
Yeah, people are going to hear you if you say it. That's the question.
Sean, I mean, we've been telling everybody on the road about it, so yeah.
The boxes? The boxes.
Yeah, the boxes.
Yeah, I think so. Yeah, that's pretty open. Yeah, no, it was in one of the articles, so it's there.
Yeah.
Go ahead, Dan.
The fact that so Skinny Monsters.
Wait, stop for a second. Breaking news. Okay, go ahead, Dan.
Where's the graphic? And a graphic.
Interstitial.
Breaking news.
We put the interstitial in there.
It was something. See, going back to the group aspect, it's something that came up when we were sitting around in December, talking about all of our stuff and all of Pete's stuff, and I said, he said, how many should I do? And I said, I don't know. I mean, how long do you want to have them? You wanted to have Pudgies for a while, right? And you did X number. You wanted to do Little Monsters and have them for a while, but when you told me the number, I told you, you're not going to have them for a while. They're going to sell out. And they did. I said, how about this? Do the Little Monster number or somewhere in that realm where you're going to sell out of the 10-count boxes. But then at the trade show, do all 10 of them in 25-count boxes. And he went, what? And I'm like, well, first of all, you're getting rid of my favorite box, which is the Tatuaje PL box. I call it the R2-D2 box. It's awesome to keep coffee in and other miscellaneous crap in your kitchen. I love that box. And I'm like, it's the same size. Do that box in multiple colors, a rainbow of colors. Imagine 10 of those freaking boxes sitting on a retailer shelf in 25 counts. And, you know, I actually threw out, like, throw a card in there. Everybody can log on to a website, vote on what their favorite is, because there will be a bell curve. And it'll be different for every region and every shop. So, like, if a shop brings in 50 boxes, like, every one that I would sell in my shop, I would say, hey, go smoke this and come back in here and tell me, like, rate them. Because I want to know, like, what my customers' favorites are. Because, like, you know, if I own a small shop, I can't afford to bring in 5 boxes of times 10, right? but I might bring five boxes in of the favorite one, and then onesie twosies of other things, and maybe there are a couple that people don't like in my shop, so I wouldn't even bring those in. And that's the direction it's going, which is really fun. So you're going to see those skinny monsters in 25-count boxes on the shelves sometime after the trade show. It's going to show them at the trade show like that and let people order them in 25 counts. That's so awesome. Very, very different than all the other samplers.
That's awesome. I mean, I feel kind of like a jerk saying this, but Pete actually told us that when he was on the show last time.
Oh, cool. Okay. Oh, just let Dan roll on then.
Oh, I was just going to let you keep talking, yeah. No, yeah. It's funny. I could tell that, Dan, you're very comfortable with the camera. You look directly into the camera when you talk. Nobody else does
looking
that.
At your eyes.
Well, now you are, but then, see, now you're now yeah. you look in the camera when you're talking.
Every once in a while, when I really want someone to know something, I'll look.
You want
to
make your point. You want to make your point. Okay, last question. Last question. And this one's going to be for the group, and it's since we've been talking about cigars, we've been talking about different beverages of different styles. So, what are your favorite pairings with the La Mission? What do you like to pair with it? I mean, off the top of my head. I would like to. I've never actually paired it, and we should do. We have a pairing show. We should do that on our pairing show. I would want to go with a nice spicy bourbon, like a Booker's or something like that. That's got a little bit of heat to it and a little bit of spice. I think that sounds like that'd be a nice pairing for me.
Mm-hmm.
So Casper, you're up first.
Since I'm in my house and I can't smoke.
Yeah.
This whistle pig rye and La Mission. Spot on.
Would be perfect. Okay. Whistle pig.
Oh, absolutely.
All right.
Rye.
Whistle pig.
Go ahead, Casper.
I would definitely do bourbon with it, but I found two beer pairings that I like a lot. And Blind Pig and Firestone Walker Parabola. You wouldn't think that an IPA would really work.
Very different beers.
Yeah, I know, but they give you wildly different experiences, and they're both awesome.
Interesting.
So I would say give it a shot with both. I found great experiences with both those beers.
That's
cigar.
That might have to happen. We're gonna do that on the show. That Blind Pig, I think that's my favorite thing that comes out of Russian River.
It's the best thing that comes out of that brewery, yeah. Hands down.
Have you had their porter?
Yes, I've had a bunch of their stuff, but I stick to Pig and because
they're sour.
The best.
Yeah.
The sours are great, but I mean, I just love. They're Blind Pig that much. It's. I think it's one of the finest examples of an IPA that I've ever had.
So. Yeah, I would definitely agree with that. It seems like it's about an hour and a half ride for me to get up there. Mm-hmm. And so my wife and I will go up on a Saturday, and we'll go up there, we'll have lunch and hang out. And on the way back, we'll hit like Bear Republic or you know a couple of different places. And every time I go, I can buy up to like one case or two cases of Pliny, but I can only get like five bottles of Blind Pig. Yeah. Or last time I couldn't get in it. I didn't have anything bottled.
Yeah, well, they're not distributing it anymore either. Not outside the brewery.
Really? I didn't know that.
Yeah.
Interesting. Fantastic beer. Dan, what's your favorite?
So I'm smoking one right now. But on the beer side, oatmeal stout. Mm-hmm. And I say that because Satin Glove's kind of a precursor to this. Satin Glove was, the surrogates project that was also San Andreas. Mm-hmm. Not as strong as La Mission. And so, a little more in the finesse realm or whatever. But I just by accident, one time I was smoking a Satin Glove and an oatmeal stout. I mean, I'm a big stout guy, but an oatmeal stout's got this texture to it. And La Mission has a texture to it. So oatmeal stout. On the beer or on the bourbon side, I would a rye because it has a bite would be nice, but a more heat forward bourbon, I think would be really interesting, but the real one it's Bordeaux, right? We actually got to drink one. Thank you, Pete. We had a Noprion and it was amazing. But an earth forward wine, if you're going to do a wine, an earth forward wine. And we always talk about pairings. We talk about monochrome pairings. And then that, like Sean hit on it. He's like, you wouldn't think an IPA, right? Mm-hmm. But certain things bring out the opposite. So you got that opposite pairing, and you got the monochrome pairing. So what I just described were three very monochrome pairings, but if you can think of something that's kind of sweet, a little bit caramely almost, to bring out that toasted kind of sweetness, that would be a great, you know, flip side pairing for this guy. So there's a ton of options with all of the above. Mm-hmm. And a lot of times I'm in that mood where I'm just like, yeah, I want to break the rules. I don't want a monochrome pairing. That's too easy. I'm already smoking it. Why do I care? I want something to bring out something that I'm not smoking. Yeah. You know, so an earth forward wine is like, oh yeah, that's easy. But you know, it's like drinking a white wine and eating steak or something. Mm-hmm. We do that all the time. Yeah, no, I mean, there's a ton of stuff that works. Every once in a while, it's like, yeah, that doesn't work at all. But you sometimes you want to think monochrome, sometimes you want to think opposite. So experiment a lot. You know, the easy answer is always, yeah, the flavors that I'm getting out of whatever I'm eating, smoking, or drinking is what I should what I should pair with any of the others. But you know, break the rules. It's fun.
Yeah, that was kind of what I went with the Allagash White and then the Lat Original. I felt like that was, in my head, it sounded like it would be good, but I was afraid that the beer was going to get run over by the cigar, but it didn't. Yep. It had that nice sweetness to it and a little bit of spice in there from those whatever spices they brew it with. What do they brew it with? Probably coriander or some bullshit. I don't know. But anyway, it was really good. So, and that's one thing that John and I do the pairing show, and that's probably the thing that I've learned the most is the pairing that you think is going to be the best, not always the best.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I agree.
Hold on there. I have one more question. And this was sent via text message, anonymous text message, by the way, which is a little bit concerning. we're off the Armed Forces Radio Network, so I'm going to ask it. And I believe this question is directed to you, Dan. And I am instructed to ask why you are called Hot Ear.
That question came from Pete.
I don't think Pete has a cell phone, but you never know.
Well, I bet he does.
No, I know.
And,
I actually
and now you have his. So go ahead and add that contact as Pete. if it wasn't Pete, it was Andy.
Oh man!
For some reason, they think I like to talk.
No way.
I think I like to talk a lot.
I never would have picked up on that.
I don't either. I'm with you. I don't understand it. But for some reason, when I would call the office, Andy would pick up the phone, and then this goes way back to when they were at the old office, and the only people involved were Pete and Andy shipping shit, right? And Andy would be on the phone, and he'd be like, "It's hot here." And Pete's like, "Oh, Dan, yeah, okay." And he's like, "I'm not." Pete would be like, "I'm not here." You know, right? All right, I'll get him off the phone. I don't know. I never got it.
I don't get it.
Yeah, I can tell you, Pete does not like to speak on the phone as much as, you know, he'll text and whatever.
Hangs up on me.
Yeah, I'm not a phone guy either. But get me in person, man, and I'm like, you know, this is kind of as person as we can get, since you're way out there. But like, ask Casey. He's like, "Oh, I'll just give the floor to Dan. Go ahead."
I'll say about tours, intro, segue to Dan.
it's usually really good, but like sometimes
it works.
Sometimes people are just like start talking amongst themselves, and then I go, "Oh yeah, okay, I should wrap it up."
No, that's good, man. I'm telling you, people tune in. They don't tune in to hear me and Logan talk. They turn in. And I must have known because when I was promoting the show, I just said Logan and I will be along for the ride. So I don't know. It was a little bit prophetic on my end, but no, this was a lot of fun. I'm really glad that we were able to have all you guys on and hang out. I've kept you here for a lot longer than I said that I would, except for Casey. Except for Casey, who showed up late, but whatever.
I'm tardy. They call me tardy.
No, you were kind enough to give me a call before the show to let me know. I really appreciate that.
Anytime.
It's very classy to take that to take my time and consider my time so much. I appreciate that. Nobody else considers respect. My time, so I appreciate it. Guys, this has been a blast. It's been a lot of fun. Thanks for taking all the questions and being so good-natured about it and generous with your time. I know our listeners have really enjoyed it. Really do appreciate it. And we'll see you guys in, what, how many weeks?
Months.
How many weeks until IPCPR? So,
coming far away.
Yeah, coming quick. Are you guys glad that it's back in Vegas?
Yes.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
That's kind of the feeling that I'm getting. I mean, New Orleans is a great town, and I mean, I loved it. We were there. My wife showed up the day the show ended, and we stayed for another 4 or 5 days and had a blast. But man, it's so hot. There's nowhere to smoke, and
that was the problem.
Yeah, that was. I mean, anytime you want to have a cigar, you got to sit outside, and it's 96 with 90% humidity.
I was not enjoying it. Plus, I was passing a kidney stone at the time. So.
Oh Jesus.
Things were not good.
Oh, man.
TMI. So surrogate.
I'm more than happy to be back in Vegas because you won't see me go outside. I get there, I'm like,
it's true.
It's awesome. Why would you go out?
Yeah.
They pump oxygen inside.
That's the beauty of it. You don't have to go outside.
Yeah.
Anyway, on that, guys, really do appreciate it. Thanks so much for hanging out.
Thanks for having us, dude. Appreciate it.
Absolutely. Everybody, thanks for tuning in to another Cigar Chat. We'll be back next Thursday. And I don't think I have our guest posted up, so it's a surprise. You have to tune in next Thursday and find out. It'll be posted up on the site pretty soon. But, guys, really do appreciate it. Thanks so much. Thanks for supporting Cigar Federation. If you haven't, download the app. And if you're downloading the podcast, give us a thumbs up or a vote or whatever and give us some feedback. Let us know what you think of the show. Really do appreciate it. Everybody have a great week since it is Monday. We had to switch to Monday because I'm going to be at the ballpark on Thursday. Baseball starts on Thursday.
That's amazing.
Isn't that crazy?
That's awesome.
Casper, are you a Dodger fan?
No, I'm a Mets fan, but I'm going to the Dodger-Anaheim game on Friday with our whole Team Tatawai softball team is going out there.
So. Oh, nice.
Nice.
That's awesome. Let me bring this up real quick. 1955, Brooklyn Dodgers. I was right.
It was the Dodgers. Okay.
Really?
Were they playing the Yankees?
Awesome.
Were they playing the Yankees? Probably.
Let me see. Hold on. Probably. More than likely. They beat the New York Yankees.
There you go. There you go. Yeah. All right.
Guys, hey, thanks.
Yeah, absolutely. We'll check you guys out in at IPCPR. Everybody have a great week. Man. Stay safe, and we'll see you on Cigar Federation.
Thanks, guys.